What's up, guys? I am James Hake. It's 9:01 a.m. U.S. Pacific Daylight Time, Wednesday, October 13th, 2021 A.D., Anno Domini, the year of our Lord. You can call in 888-775-3773. Lots of stuff I want to talk about today. Some quick news stories. Lego are a bunch of, I don't want to call them that, child misguiders. And you know what Jesus said about the child misguiders? Anyone who misleads or offends a one of these children, it would be better for him to have a large millstone tied around his back and thrown into the sea than to harm one of these children. And they're harming the children by pretending the LGBT madness. Lego is part of that. I have some information. I got yelled at for talking about Don Lemon, making a passing remark about Don Lemon yesterday. And so I have why I bring up Don Lemon. The some history or past video of Don Lemon. Quite extensive, actually. More than 10 minutes worth of clips to share with you. And other stuff. Fake racism, a funny confrontation between so-called lawn care workers and this purportedly white guy who does not like dust being kicked up by the leaf blowers, and I honestly don't blame him on that. Interesting little confrontation there. But first, before all of that, we have, you know how I like to share Christian music from way back in the olden days when I was in my 20s and teens. Well, I have a song to share with you. This is Furthermore. I've been playing Furthermore this week on special request. Shout out. And you know who. Not you know who, I know who. Shout out to I know who. Furthermore, from the 1999 album Fluorescent Jellyfish in the Christian label Tooth and Nail. This track is entitled, This track is entitled, man, I'm blanking on it already. Being a Ghost Isn't That Great. Isn't That Great. Is Not That Great. Being a Ghost Is Not That Great. Am I butchering the name of the song? Well, enjoy. You'll see the track if you're watching the video. No lyrics, but you will see the album art. Enjoy. Being a Ghost Isn't That Great. By Furthermore, grin and bear it, you musical Philistines. Enjoy. What's up, Skip? Being a ghost isn't all that. All you need to do, cause we're jealous of you. I'm unloved, undreamed of. Nothing to say, we cry a while, a while. Being a ghost is the most boring. I'm full of bones when the rain is pouring. I saw poltergeist, but it's nowhere as nice. Cause every wall I walk through, someone I can't talk to. I'm not. As well as a sixth sense of humor, at least that's the rumor. Being a ghost isn't all that. All you need to do, cause we're jealous of you. I'm unloved, what? Undreamed of, what? Nothing to say. We cry a while, a while. Being a ghost isn't all that. All you need to do, cause we're jealous of you. I'm unloved, what? Undreamed of, what? Nothing to say. We cry a while, a while. Being a ghost this close to holding a review that doesn't hold true. I wish I wasn't watching you through this one-way window in limbo. Nowhere to go, I have no potential. Don't have any goals and no residential. Eventually, a change of part will start me off with the bath to wash off the invisible. If only I could be more colorful, but lines to stay inside's what I lack. Let's flash back to the world when I was in it. He'll be dead in 60 seconds. Well, he'll have to wait a minute.
Isn't this nice?
Imitating a totally failed culture is cringe, says Berlin.
Wow, fair point.
Being a Can't we just have a moment of silence instead? Asks Raymond 11.
No. Being a ghost isn't that great. I made a date with God to discuss if I could rejuvenate back to my late physical form. I had to fill out a form, and my appearance was born into the truth. We knew we remodeled me disembodied. Now I'm embodied with flesh. Out on the beach, I forgot what it feels like to make an imprint in the sand underneath, going deep in the water, but waves crashed and smashed in my head, smack dab on the rocks. So my body's lying in the box, and I'm sad to say I'm back in the same spot. Ghost.
This nice, Hake. Thank you, Shane Shinner. Press one if you believe the white guy singing this sags his pants like a black guy, says Skip. Well, guys, thank you for bearing with me through that. Hope you somewhat enjoyed it. Thank God for Eminem, says Malkuth X. Yikes. Yikes. But anyway, guys, let's get right on with the show!
1, 2, 3, 4. Oh, it's the Hake Report. The Hake Report. La, la, la.
Hey guys! So, how are you guys doing? I am fine. Berlin says, Hake usually has pretty good taste in music. I miss the punk stuff now. Well, I appreciate that, Berlin. Yeah, maybe it was a one-off that I liked that. Morning, Hake and the Facebook crew. Morning, Facebook crew. Yes, indeed. ASMR music. That's supposed to, like, put you in a trance-like state or calm you down or something like that? His delivery is perfect, says OD Red Skull. Hip-hop with the inspiration or Christianity. Takes me back to the 90s. Hey, thank you, Matt the American. Nice to see you, man. Homegrown Christians really listened to this, says Peter Almas. Guys, you know, Bass Viking says over there on DLive, wow, 10 minutes of Don Lemon, gonna be a rough watch. I know. It will be rough, but you'll be like, whoa, maybe. If you are not already familiar with his several years back, how he used to be. Quick news items for you guys. Let me plow through these headlines for you. It's a crazy job situation, I hear. You know, you hear that there's lots of jobs available out there for you guys. The U.S. workforce, according to the far-left female-run outlet The Skim, yesterday the Labor Department set a record 4.3 million Americans quit their, what they call, I don't want to say it, but C word, horrible jobs in August. That's nearly 3% of the labor force. At the beginning of the scamdemic, listen to this, over 22 million people lost their jobs as businesses closed up shop. The communist shutdowns. To me, they were not needed, and to this day, they're not needed. By the way, I'm wearing a... Have an amazing Christmas. Amazing Christmas monkeys. See it? T-shirt. Originally available on the Fallen State Teespring store. Shout out to... Lock Your Door. Boom. It says Lock Your Door there. You probably can't see it exactly, but... Amazing, have an amazing Christmas. Amazing Christmas monkeys. So festive. I know it's October 13th, but I'm in media now, guys, and I'm in the advertising business. And advertisers and media people start celebrating stuff or putting you in the mood. Well, I don't know if it's putting you in the mood. Several months early. And we all know that Halloween is, I guess, All Hallows Eve. Was that originally Christian? Is it satanic? Did it originate with the Druids? Is that the true white heritage, Druids? I don't know. But I like this design. Shout out to Lock Your Door. Lock Your Door makes cool designs and memes. Follow him on Twitter. I think it's @_lock_. Let me see if I can _lock_your_door. See if this works. Yes, indeed. @_lock_your_door on Twitter. It's always changing. I think he gets kicked off or something. Too spicy. But right on, buddy. Right on, man. But anyway, speaking of jobs, 22 million people lost their jobs with the communist shutdowns. That's pure evil, in my opinion. Recent months, companies putting up hiring signs met with crickets, sparking concerns of a labor shortage. Millions of people are quitting their jobs. The Great Resignation is what some are calling it. They want higher paying jobs, remote work. Hospitality and retail industries hit especially hard. Concerns about the virus. They're scaremongering, or fearmongering if you prefer that term, but I prefer scaremongering. About the China virus and child care. You know, if the majority are quitting or women, that's fine. Stay home. Get married, become sensible. Right? It's too early to tell, says the far-left female-run outlet The Skim, if vax mandates are driving employees to quit. Well, of course it is. But I do encourage employees not to quit over them. Because you want to, you don't want to quit. If they fire you, I'm not saying to get the vaccine necessarily. Anyway, companies are looking for seasonal workers, by the way. You know, Christmas time and stuff like that. We'll see what happens. And by the way, speaking of that, illegal amnesty. That as in so-called workers. People who come up here for work for money. For money. Estamos en el norte. The far-left female-run outlet The Skim says Homeland Security. So-called Homeland Security, which is a total misnomer. As in the Department of Homeland Security. They said Immigration and Customs Enforcement, or ICE. You know how the radicals want to shut down ICE? I'm not MGTOW, American creationist. They're calling Hake MGTOW. No, I'm not. I never was. Well, I did joke about being bachelor for life, but it's mostly joking. We'll stop mass worksite arrests of so-called undocumented immigrants. ICE will stop mass worksite arrests of illegal aliens. They're not undocumented. If they're working for people, most of the time, because I've worked with illegals, I suspect. Not here at Bond, that I know of. Side eye at Chris. Just kidding. They get these things called, in California at least, and I don't know if it's just California or if it's nationwide, they get these I-9s. An I-9 is a form that you can fill out as an illegal alien. And it says, oh, I have a social security card. Never mind that it was from MacArthur Park, which is a once beautiful park in, like, downtown LA area that is a place where people sell fake social security or stolen social security cards and IDs and mess like that, right? So under Trump, ICE was arresting masses of illegals who were working at job sites. ICE raids at places like factories and food processing plants became common practice, according to The Skim, and led to hundreds of arrests. Thank God. Thank Trump. Now, DHS is shifting its focus, meaning they're giving de facto amnesty back to the illegal aliens who are taking the jobs away from the blacks who are too dumb and lazy and on welfare to notice, or on unemployment or whatever, or they're going to government jobs. DHS shifting its focus to crack down on employers who exploit their employees. That's, what does that have to do with Homeland Security? DHS is going after employers who exploit their employees. That includes those who pay substandard wages, provide unsafe working conditions, and are involved in human trafficking. Whether knowingly or unknowingly, who knows? Immigration advocates applauded the changes, meaning the people who are in favor of this invasion. They called on the administration to provide permanent protections for millions of illegal aliens. They call them undocumented immigrants, including the Dreamers. The Dreamers are plenty documented. It's a total lie. And they're not immigrants. They're invaders. What a mess. I will be getting to your calls, guys. Just want to plow through this. The vaccine mandate in the NBA. Who needs, other than children, correct me if I'm wrong, but who needs these so-called vaccines less than fit athletes? Honestly, call in and correct the record on it for me. This guy, Kyrie Irving, is he the guy who was a flat earther and moon landing guy who said that that's his favorite conspiracy theory? I don't know. Brooklyn Nets general manager Sean Marks has confirmed Kyrie Irving will not, and shout out to Big Bump for the tip on this, and to the far left female run out with the skin, sharing a CNN article on it. But Big Bump shared a different one with me from New York Post, which is a little bit more reliable, I would say, than the far left enemies of America, CNN, although not that much better always. He's banned. He's going to be banned from their team until he's, quote unquote, vaccinated. Kyrie Irving, he's black, but he's an athlete who at least tries or something to think for himself. And he's seeing all these people losing their jobs and stuff, and he's wants to give a voice to the voiceless, I think is what he said. He will not play or practice with the team until he is eligible to be a full participant. Because this guy has not been, quote-unquote, vaccinated, so there's, like, a home game that he's not allowed to play at because the Barclays Center over there in Brooklyn Nets, whatever. They say, oh, the city of Brooklyn, or New York City, right, says, you have to be vaccinated to come to big events. The evil communists. Instead of dealing with the evil communists and overpowering them, they're oppressing the little guy. And by little guy, I don't mean Kyrie Irving, because he's not oppressed. He's willingly taken this. But they are Kyrie Irving, the tennis player. They're going after him. Am I pronouncing his name correctly? I don't want to pronounce it like a woman. Like a woman's name would be pronounced. Kyrie has made a personal choice, and we respect his individual right to choose, says Sean Marks. He's trying to play both sides. Currently, I noticed that they're using a whole lot of currently at this time, the Brooklyn Nets, because they want to leave it open to changing their mind depending on the politics. So keep on pushing, guys, for the side of freedom. This is America. Let me take a few screenshots of this Kyrie Irving guy so that you can see what he looks like. He's black. Looks like Joel, basically. Picture Joel. That's him. No offense, Joel. I don't know. Yeah. Because there's some... He's like fist-bumping little kids. Seems like a nice guy, except they force him to wear this mask when he's playing basketball. It's ridiculous. But right on to Kyrie Irving for expressing being an American, or somewhat more American than these commies who are in the NBA kissing up to the destruction. Here he is with the little kid. Let me share some of these screenshots with you guys, if I can quickly do it. There we go. Take off that one. Okay. It's dragging over. Boom. Should be there. Let me know. It's a bunch of screenshots out in the main folder. Kyrie loves basketball, wants to be out there, said this Marks guy, who's the general manager of the Brooklyn Nets, NBA is basketball, professional basketball. They're enemies of the people, too. And they have been that way for a long time. Don't watch this professional sports stuff. It's not good for you. Go out and play if you can. Irving stands to lose $17 million or more from sitting out of games in New York. The Nets will still play him for the road games, so they said. Trying to undercut him from filing a grievance with the Players Association. There he is. Doesn't that look like Joel a little bit? Maybe not at all. Doesn't that look like Denzel Washington? Is that Obama right there? I'm joking around, like, you know, the all blacks look alike meme. Practice in the park. There's one where he's fist bumping a light-skinned mixed black kid, or maybe, look at that. Aww. But why is he, I mean, he's forced to wear that mask thing. This is a choice that Kyrie's had, and he was well aware of that. We've had multiple conversations. Conversations were good. They were very clear, clearly outlined. This is where we stand right now, today. Right now, today, Mark says. Durant, Kevin Durant, James Harden were kept in the loop. They bowed the knee, of course. Don't those guys kiss up to the Black Lives Matter madness? I wonder whether Kyrie falls for that mess. Shout out to that other, what's that other guy's name who I was praising for not getting the so-called vaccine, because he's already had the virus and, you know, he's young and fit and he's a Christian and he didn't bow down to the BLM mess. I'm talking about a different basketball player, not Kyrie, 23 years old, and he was called an anti-vaxxer. He's like, no, I'm pro-vaccine, just not for this one, for me personally, because I've already had the virus, and some studies have shown that that's better. And that there are potential risks, especially for young men. Very rare, you know, with the heart inflammation stuff. So right on, Kyrie Irving. Hold fast, hold strong, don't be selfish. By the way, speaking of selfishness, Lego. Last little point before I get to some calls, guys. Lego, pro-LGBTQ. And I want to use the word that you guys throw around. But let me withhold that. I'll put it into my blog post. Because that word gets thrown around too much, in all honesty. And it's thrown around as an attack on men, when actually women are more likely to do it, I suspect. But Lego, the Washington Compost, and the far-left female-run outlet, The Skim, says, Lego... As in Legos? Did you guys play with Legos when you were kids? Children? I did. We built castles and stuff. And cars and things. Lego vows to remove, L-E-G-O, to remove gender bias from toys following the Gina Davis Institute survey. Who's Gina Davis Institute? I don't know. Maybe we'll read about it right now. And it's put out Tuesday, yesterday, by Amy Cheng. C-H-E-N-G. Lego is the world's largest toy maker. Whoa. Pledged to eliminate gender stereotypes from its products. Stupid. Including labeling that marks toys as for girls or for boys as part of a bid to match the wishes of its young customers. Yeah, brainwash and participate in the brainwashing. And fall in line with the brainwashing. Despite the progress made in girls brushing off prejudice at an early age. Oh yeah, girls, that's what they really fight against. It's prejudice. Give me a break. General attitudes surrounding play and creative careers remain unequal and restrictive, says the Lego is Danish? Lego's from Denmark? Psh. Lincoln Logs were Gen X, says Jim Justice. I remember those too. Colorful building blocks is what Legos are, right? I have one headline on this. United Nations Day of the Girl was Monday. What the heck? The UN are enemies of all decency. All decency. The UN. They are evil. Girls today feel increasingly confident to engage in all types of play and creative activities, remain held back by society's ingrained gender stereotypes as they grow older. Give me a break. Lego's move comes amid heightened debate about the role that toys play in creating and perpetuating gender stereotypes. As you heard on Saturday, you may have heard, I didn't mention this until now, California's beta governor, Gavin Newsom, and I do mean gruesome, Gavin Newsom, Democrat, signed into law a new law requiring large retail stores in the nation's most populous state to provide gender-neutral shopping sections for childcare items and toys beginning in 2024. What a sicko. The toy maker's announcement comes in response to a global survey commissioned by Lego and conducted by the Gina Davis Institute on Gender in Media that found that parents and to a lesser extent, their children are still influenced by gendered notions of career. Young girls, they don't need a career. That's been the destruction of the women. They're not having the babies, at least the educated ones, so-called educated ones, are not having the babies on time. So they're getting older, and the babies are coming out all messed up. I bet you that's part of all this increase. I know you guys, some of you guys blame the vaccines falsely, according to YouTube, for the, you know, the developmental and brain problems that children have. I suspect that it's not just what they're putting in the food, not just the, what they're putting in, you know, because they're giving like 22 different shots or more to children for different vaccinations. I had like three, maybe. I had a TB skin test, maybe MMR, measles, mumps, rubella. I don't know. What did they give children in the 80s? Not 22 shots, I don't think. So it's like through the roof. It's off the deep end. It's ridiculous, in my opinion. But it's not just the food and the shots. I think it's also the cultural rot and decline. Telling women, oh, get your career. Making them miserable. Be feminist. Hate men. As if they don't hate him enough already, you know? For instance, when asked which gender immediately comes to mind upon thinking of scientists, parents from seven countries were more likely to say male. Duh! They pretend that this is a problem. Okay, Hake, shut up and get to a call, says Counter Signal. Hold on, man, I will, I promise. Let the kids decide what they want to play, how they want to play with it, and how they want to express themselves, says this evil woman, Madeline Di Nono, the Institute's chief executive. So, they're infiltrators. It's evil. Julia Golden is Lego's chief product and marketing officer. Our job now is to encourage boys and girls who want to play with sets that may have traditionally been seen as not for them. Evan Lowe is a radical Democrat assemblyman who helped write that California law. Evan Lowe, I think that guy was, is he an Asian? Yeah, the sleazy guy. And is he a so-called member of the LGBTIQ mess community thing? He definitely looks like he's the chair of the California LGBT Legislative LGBT caucus. So evil. And he looks like that guy from, what is it? Harold and Kumar? That Asian who's in the pot smokers movies? Well, he doesn't quite look like that. But it's sick. In short, it's sick. That guy doesn't, he has no business making any laws with regard to children. Stay away from the children. You sicko? Anyway, that's that. Just letting you know, boycott Lego. Boycott these evil California Democrats. But get in and be good examples, right? It's so gross, though. Anyway, I'm going to get to Don Lemon, but first, let me get to a call or two. Social Pariah is in Denver, Colorado. Social Pariah, thanks for holding, man. What's up?
How's it going, Hake?
Going well. How are you?
Oh, not bad. Yeah, I was just talking. I was thinking about what it's going to take to make the country, how we're ever going to win an election with changing demographics, you know, which is going to, if they flip Texas, we're not going to see a Republican in office for a long time.
Yeah, let's stick with...
Let's carry so many electoral votes.
I understand your concern. They want to turn Texas blue. There are decent Texans, and I'm not talking about... I'm not talking about Greg Abbott, because I don't necessarily consider him a decent at all Texan. But there are, you know, there are people fighting to not let Texas turn blue. It is turning that way. Don't worry about the future or an if and what may happen when. Or why are you bringing that up? Yeah. Why are you bringing that up?
Well, I just think that, I mean, whenever, like I noticed the other day, whenever you were saying that I don't know if it was because he was black or if it was because he was a black Israel, Hebrew Israelite.
Yeah.
But you said, I just don't want you around me. and I'm like, that was worse than just saying, I think, than saying, you know, that after that, any hope that he was going to, you know, change and, you know, that he would flip and we'd get him on our side is out the window.
Oh, you think so? I don't think so, man.
No? Okay.
Well, yeah, I mean, okay. But why do you, you know, do you remember who I said that to? Whom? To whom I said that?
I think it was that Dr. Detroit guy. Yeah,
that was Chuck. You think that of all the things I've said to Chuck, you think that little thing? If you think Chuck is at all an open person going to change his mind, and he might be, I don't know, but you think that's going to push him away from becoming on our side being like conservative and sane for the country? That's what you mean. What you mean by our side, right? Or not hating whites?
I really don't know. I don't know much about the guy. I know that there's a lot of people that just aren't going to change no matter what. That,
right.
But like.
Okay, let's say a listener, a black listener, who's more independent thinking, but he believes that racism exists maybe, or he falls for some of that stuff, but he's opening up, and he's a hearer. He overhears this conversation between me and Chuck, where I'm like, I like you over there, that you're saying that may turn away a sensible person who otherwise was thinking, you know what, I like this James guy, and I like these conservatives, these white conservatives. They're decent people, but James just said, I don't want you here, to Chuck. And you people like Chuck type blacks, which there's all too many of them. I'm chuckling. I understand your point.
I would like to see, I mean, you know, the only way, because of changing demographics, the only way we're going to win is if we change hearts and minds. And
I mean, I agree with that to a point. Yeah, I mean, we can't just rely on the whites. We got to appeal to the whites who are alienated by this evil anti-white culture. But we also have to appeal to all decent people to not hate whites, to not hate America.
I agree.
Yeah,
I'm like,
that's what you're saying.
I'm totally on board with that. There has to be a benchmark that you can't deviate from, that, you know, we can't just say, okay, I like you, you're a transsexual, and I want to make you happy, I don't want you to be miserable, but if I change my ethics to suit them, then we have no moral base.
Right.
So, I mean, we're just constantly going to be shifting.
Yeah.
You know.
So you're not for that. You're not a not to pick on Charlie Kirk, but you're not a Charlie Kirk lolbertarian, conservatarian, where you'll just surrender morals to appeal to people. But you don't want me to be saying, I want you, I like you living far away from me to the blacks.
Well, I think I personally would rather have a cool black guy living next to me than some staunch, just butthole of a white guy living next to me, you know, that just, I mean, that doesn't yield, cuts his grass the same way. You get like a quarter inch over in his yard cutting the grass. Because you can't, you got to have multiple, you know, the personal perspective is why they call it that, is because that's the way you see things.
But that's not probably that's a false dilemma. You're not going to have most of the time you're not going to run into a jerk white, and most of the time you're not going to run into a truly kind black.
But like, even like
neighbor.
Jesse, like if you had the perspective, if Jesse hadn't had a radio show and you met him, you might have thought, well, maybe I just don't want you near me, and you'd have given up a lot. I know in Jesse, you've grown a lot. He's, you know, I mean, he brings a lot to the table, and that's a lot of black people. They bring a lot of things to the table that, you know.
Not a lot of black people. I was never prejudiced, had any prejudice against blacks.
Jesse did not open my
mind to black people, except to realize just how far down they've fallen and continue to fall because of paying attention to what's going on.
But I always knew
that blacks fell for the false racism stuff. I'm saying that there's some sensible blacks out there.
Yeah, they do.
Every now and then.
America would not be a better place for not having black people. I truly believe that. Skip was saying the other day, whenever he was, he said he had to panhandle to get for money. He said the black people were always the ones that, you know, they have a lot of times they have more compassion than
Don't listen to Skip. That's not compassion. That's not good.
Well, he
mentioned that Skip was out panhandling and the blacks would give him stuff and the whites would keep on driving. That's because that's a good thing that whites were doing that. The handouts are not usually good for you. And blacks have a false compassion, man. Do you want to address this caller, Chris? Galaxy Brain? Or
I'll talk for a little bit.
Yeah. Chris would like to address you on your thinking, social pariah. How old are you, by the way?
I'll try.
You Gen X? You Gen X?
Huh?
Are you
Gen X
or millennial? Okay. Go for it.
Okay, so I have to, I don't know if scold is the word here, but you gotta, this type of thinking, in my opinion, still is based in somewhat of a fear of like being called racist or something like that. You have to live and act in the world the way that it is. I can't change the things, you know, necessarily, but white people have been just going out of their way to cater everything and make up all these excuses for black people. I mean, now just any kind of non-white person, just in general, the evidence shows, the world as it is, that the compassion, quote unquote, we shouldn't be compassionate like we are, but the compassion that whites have shown will not be returned. And it's not to say that we hate non-white people, or we want to bring them down or something like that. It's just they are not living in a way that, I don't know, are moving things forward. It's not helping us out, and we are just bringing ourselves down. This type of talk is kind of shooting yourself in the foot. I think we have to escape this binary of of, well, if we're not helping non-whites, we hate them. We have to get out of that type of framing. If they can't help themselves and if they want to work against us, I simply cannot, deal with with those people. They're working against me. Even though they might not want to, they are. And I don't want to try to help them continue that way. It's time for tough love. And I mean very, very tough love. Like, we have to be able to literally, like, you know, you got to wipe your hands of these people. I'm not saying just, oh, round them up, put them in the train cars. Like, you know, all this stuff, it's not as extreme as people think it is. We just cannot stay in this binary that I just laid out. It's either we help them and we give them all this stuff, or we hate them and we want them dead and we want them, you know, out of the country, X, Y, and Z. There's much more in between that. And if we don't escape that binary, we're going to, either way, you're going to be dead.
You follow that?
Yeah. I agree that we, you know, in large, we need to get back to Christian values, which is a good work ethic, which is compassion without emotion, like Jesse says.
Yeah.
That you should love people enough to not enable them, and to, you know, which we kind of have, which I largely put that on the government and FDR and LBJ,
man.
For, you know.
It's not just the government. It's a problem within white culture that has become too nice and saying I don't want to live around you people is gonna turn off blacks. A sensible black who is looking for the truth is gonna see whether I have a decent spirit or not. He's not gonna get hung up on a. He's not going to get hung up so much on a word that I say or a statement that I make about not wanting to live around Chuck from Detroit and his type of people, his type of black. You know what I mean?
Yeah. It's like, but there's types of whites that I don't want to live around too. You know?
You don't have to say that. That's a false version of fairness. That is, yeah. I'm gonna cover some false fairness from like Don Lemon, for example. But that's
just because that's true. I mean, you're going out of your way to even mention it.
Right.
Like there, you know, if you want to just be general, there are types of people that I don't want to live by. That's just a general consensus. Like, I mean, anybody could say that and I would be like, yeah, that sounds right to me. Everybody thinks that.
And it's way out of proportion among the blacks as far as those type of people that have this crazy attitude. And unpredictable when they're gonna get a nasty attitude towards you because you look at them wrong or they start suddenly suspecting you of snitching on them or being a male Karen or something, which is a slur against whites. How much experience do you have dealing with blacks, social pariah? Just out of curiosity, personally, in your life, day to day.
I'm sorry, can you repeat that?
How much experience do you have dealing with blacks?
I've worked with black people, and, you know, the whenever I went in, usually the ones that the guys that I worked with were really cool, and we would, like, make ethnic jokes about each other.
Right.
Just, you know, like, one guy I worked with, we worked together as meat cutters at Walmart, and he was saying that, he's like, it's all right, bro. He said, you want to get in line quicker, just start shaking in the line at Walmart and say, I got a gun. Because, you know, the stereotype of white people being all serial killers.
So did you ever have a disagreement with these guys?
Huh?
Did you ever have a disagreement with these guys?
No, we get along great.
Probably because you're an agreeable person. And that's part of the problem with whites. And I'm not saying that there was a time that you needed to disagree, because I don't know. But there's a lot of people who are... Whites kind of have a people-pleasing problem, and blacks have the opposite of people-pleasing problem, where they'll be pushy when they really don't need to be, And they'll start being suspicious of other people, thinking other people are being suspicious of them, by the way. And they have, like, the opposite problem. Whereas blacks have anger, the whites' anger manifests more as fear and kissing up. And that's a bad combination.
Yeah, it's definitely a different culture. But, I mean, on the whole, I mean, we're basically all the same. I mean, we bump up against the same problems, you know. And
I know that. Does my show... What is your issue with me? Was it my one statement to Chuck, or with the feel that you get from my show lately?
Well, I guess it's more the wording, you know. I mean, if you start off insulting somebody, then they're not going to hear the next couple of words you say after that.
Have I done that more than just with Chuck? Just that one time where I told him, "Oh, live far away from me, please." Or,
well, I think sometimes, yeah. I don't know when you're joking. Sometimes I think maybe I've taken you literally, but sometimes, yeah. You know, it's. I'm trying to think of other times, but yeah, I think probably you could be a little more diplomatic.
Can I just say one more thing?
Yeah. How's my stream, guys? I think my stream might have dropped temporarily and went back up, but that's all right. That's Twitter. I could be completely mistaken. Go on.
Still going?
It looks like it's good.
Just really quickly, I think there's this notion that white people pushing back. And this is, I mean, black people think this all the time, that the equivalent of, like, white people pushing back or, like, getting our way or something like that is the equivalent of, like, we're going to kill them, or, like, we're going to, like, put them in chains and all this stuff, which is nonsensical. But there is – I don't even think it takes, like, my type of sight or foresight or just the ability to see what's going on. The way that I want to live, and it's clear the way white people have lived in America, you know, the problems that you run into and all this multicultural stuff, yeah, sure, there's problems with all that. But the way white people have generally been going with this country has been just fine. It's been the best. It's been the best of the best. Now, you include all these non-white people, and they get all riled up, and, you know, they have to adjust to us. And I don't want to ramble on here, but what I'm getting at is they think that, again, that we want to kill them or something like that. I don't want to do anything like that, but they have demonstrated things that they're very violent. They're very destructive, and it's very detrimental. So when I'm presenting this information, I'm not worried about being offensive, because I don't actually want to kill these people. I'm trying to make everything better. I'm trying to lift all boats, in fact. But to me, they're demonstrating that they do, in fact, want some. They are destructive. They are violent. And if you're weighing me being offensive to them, or them potentially killing me, it's not even a question. Like, there is no option. Like, just because I'm offending somebody and they're not getting exactly what they want, but I'm still alive and they will still be alive, certainly, versus them getting their way and taking over all this stuff, destroying the country, hurting people, it's not even a comparison. It's oil and water. It's just crystal clear.
Did you grow up in the Denver area?
What to do?
No, I grew up in the South, in Texas, in East Texas.
Around blacks?
Yeah. No, I didn't until I started. I grew up and I started working. You know, outside of the little town I grew up in. But, you know, it's, I think Chris is right that, like we were saying, that, you know, on the whole, like, Christianity, have, you know, bringing back moral ethics, getting our country back, there can't be any compromise. But we have to work within, you know, I guess the black people that are coming around, it's not like a color issue. It's more of a moral issue. And if you look at it from that perspective, he's probably right. We just, you know, there is no, there is, it isn't a color barrier. We need to fight against evil, no matter what color. Is that basically what he was saying? More or less?
Sort of, but you're adding in this not about color stuff, which if whites don't need to be told that it's not about color, because whites aren't into the race thing. You're acting like we're, like my show is into the race thing, and it's not. It's all about the morals.
Yeah, from that perspective, then we have no beef, no problem.
But my pointing out the moral problems of the blacks hating the whites and the POCs hating the whites. And the fact that they're into their racism, their race stuff, and they're into this false identity stuff, and they're into hating whites. And it seems like my pointing that out and not wanting to be around people like that is making me look like the racist to you. Not that you think that, but that I'm not going to be appeasing and appealing to people, and because of the way and the wording, and you're not sure if I'm joking. Nick says, if anything, if Jesse, Trump, Bond, and other stuff has shown me anything, is that you don't have to soften the truth. People respond; it wakes people up. So you don't have to kiss up and say whites do it too. Sometimes there's jerk whites around too. Just because blacks are majority jerks doesn't mean that. Some whites aren't jerks too. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Jerk whites aren't that bad.
I totally agree. I probably didn't. I ran out of time. I'm in my incredibly loud work truck.
No problem, man.
I'll get back to you on it. I'm gonna kind of digest what you were talking about, and I'll get back to you on it.
Right on, man. Good to hear from you.
Yep.
Take care, Social Pariah. All right. Bye. There were some funny chats. Ragnar0321 says, oh no, James ruined any chance for Chuck to come to our side. let me read some super chats, guys. Lin Yen Chin says, Lego, as in the... It's on the tip of my tongue. I just want to call them pedophiles. But I don't want to call them pedophiles because I think that's thrown around too much. But it is a molestation of the kids to pretend... Oh, and this Evan Lowe guy. I just dragged a couple of screenshots of Evan Lowe from his Twitter profile and his Wikipedia image just to show you this Asian guy. I presume that he's Asian or Pacific Islander or whatever. They like to distinguish themselves as not Asian. The Pacific Islanders. This guy is pushing out this law that the beta governor signed of California, pushing children... pretending that it's abuse of children to have boys and girls toys. Give me a break. So Lin Yen Chin said, there is this guy. Look at him. 37 years old. Been in politics forever. He's a LGBTIQ person. What is that, Chinese or something? I forget what. Look at that. Rainbow Cal LGBT. California LGBT mess. Part of Silicon Valley, former mayor, hashtag stop Asian hate, just the scum of the earth. That's the type of Asian. Oh, look, there he is posing next to cackling Kamala Harris and a bunch of females and another male, purportedly. Sick. That's what I mean by a lot of the Asians, especially the so-called educated ones, are... I love uneducated people, as Trump said. Chris says, why are we going out of our way to help people who hate us? There are people out there who have small disagreements whom we can help or get along with or whatever. Anyway, Lin Yen Chin, back to his super chat. Lego is of Denmark. Did you know that I'm part Danish? Psh. Not like Lego, though. I'm not like that. They have great DNA. Denmark, the Danish. The Danes. Inherited through the spirit of their forefathers. Spirit? You mean biospirit, Lin Yen Chin? But breaking... that was a call yesterday. Breaking from the spirit is causing their genetic potential to dissipate rapidly. They are being devoured by multi-communism. Well, thank you, Lin Yen Chin. Yeah. Malkuth X over there on YouTube says, Hake, you're appeasing and simping for your listeners a lot more. What's gotten into you, boy? What do you mean, man? In what way am I appeasing and simping? I may be. What do you mean? Explain. Explain to me, Malkuth X. Lin Yen Chin also states, gone are the days of 1787, where our behavior caused whites to see us as three-fifths of a person. That's not what it was. He said he insists that it was, though. Lin Yen Chin insists that that's the three-fifths compromise. We really thought that they were three-fifths human, which is majority human, so be happy, right? But I didn't consider that. It was for representation. I mean, they're slaves. They're not supposed to get representation. Psh. Anyway, now only one-tenth of us are humane or sane, says Lin Yen Chin. We fell from being only one-fourth as decent as our enslaved ancestors. That's exponential depreciation of character. We a mess. Interesting, Lin Yen Chin. Because Lin Yen Chin is black part. If you're part black, you're all black, right? Unless you're mixed like that one girl who is mocking Obama for being that. And Asmodor yesterday with the super chat over there on Odyssey, odyssee.com/@thehakereport/live. He states, don't listen to these wignats, which is short for Wigger nationalists, which is white wannabe N-word, basically. Which, perhaps somebody can explain that to me one day, but that's fine for now. We'll put it that. And he says, they accomplished nothing, these wignats, accomplished nothing. And if they knew how to have an impact, they would. They're basically white Hebrew Israelites who just talk tough and annoy people. I'm adding that in because that's what black Hebrew Israelites are. Interesting. And then I think that was a reference to... a caller of mine who told me grow a backbone yesterday. But I don't know in what way he meant. What would I cover that would give me that backbone? I think he wanted me to start lifting weights and fighting. Anyway, thank you guys. It is 9:59 over here in Los Angeles, and I have another song to play for you before I get to Don Lemon, and others. I have more clips to share with you. Funny clips, actually. One funny clip, actually. But first, let me share with you a furthermore track. Speaking of the W word, is Wigger a bad word? This track is from the 2003 album, She and I, from Furthermore, on Tooth and Nail Records. Furthermore is a band that I kind of enjoyed to listening to when I was in college, and shortly afterwards. This track is entitled 82, guys. Listen to 82 from Furthermore, or press mute, cover your ears, grin and bear it, you musical Philistines. I'll be right back, guys.
Show me something so plain and ordinary that you would say it's just so outright different. Yes, I'd say so. Stay so close to me, cause I won't play so rough. Set for if I'm sick in the head. Whoever said they were perfectly sound, a lovely wannabe. Wannabe tough guy wants a piece of me. Here, take both of my legs and walk home peacefully. Can you believe it or not? It doesn't
doesn't matter whether you're happy or my main man misery. We try to read minds instead of reading the signs given within our present electric company. But I know that you can do better, 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 better than you even know. Cause I've seen you run circles around you. So show, show, show me 82. What's your escape? Spacecraft, comical, look at my flat. Or a land of polychrome. Bury your head in a book at home. My favorite is playing around with words on a microphone like this. Let's go splash. Self-esteem around. Seems like screaming and yelling but barely making a sound. Likewise, changing just because I say so. Rearranging yourself with nowhere to go. Feeling vertigo. Also, I wanna remind you. Haunting memories are hunting you down. Wanting you to drown. In an obsession of them and then depression cause of them. Looking up from below. Tripping up your EGIIO. I know that you can do better, 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 better than you even know. Cause I've seen you run circles around you. So show, show, show me 82. I know that you can do better, 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 better than you even know. Cause I've seen you run circles around you. So show, 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 show me 82. I'm saying the same things in different ways. What? In the past will be the latest craze. Why? With the baby boomer babies who are so into retro acting out the meat decade. And I'm no different. Can be callous. Go ask Alice. She's so. Now it's nature to hate yourself as a palace. Pretty enough to make their eyes feel jealous. But empty and shivering, silvery senior citizens sitting in solitary and wishing that you could be young again. At the other end are kids who want to look older. But I don't see your penciling and wrinkles into their complexion. I know that you can do better, 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 better than you even know. Cause I've seen you.
So good, am I right? Or not?
What is worse than walking all over the people you care the most about? I know this all too well. Well, that's what happens when you see everyone as a step on your staircase to the sky. And drink up all the times they help in a time of drought. Pull yourself off the shelf and tear all those pages out. See, we don't shop at meat markets and we don't care who's whom. We don't get naked and we don't trash hotel rooms. So we'll remain uninteresting to the press. The only thing I'll address is their underestimation of the people. God bless. I know that you can do better, 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 better than you even know. Cause I've seen you run circles around you. So show, show, show me 82. I know that you can do better, 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 better than you even know. Cause I've seen you run circles around you. So show, 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 show me 82. I know that you can do better.
AC's feeling good. Oh my gosh.
Cause I've seen you run circles around you. So show, show, show me 82.
Limp Bizkit and Madonna had a baby, says Panda Ladies. Not a fan, says Thomas Gorby. Wigger is like the N-word. Only whites are allowed to say wigger. This is more evil. I feel bad, like maybe I shouldn't say that. Elijah says, that finger is crooked, America first. Yeah, I used to write hard, so I think my finger turned crooked. Or no, that's my left. Oh, I used to write with my left sometimes. NWA was a psyop. Those guys still trying to be gangster. Look at Ice Cube, he trying to be hard. And been Rick since the late 80s. Malkuth says, Malkuth X says, press 3 of Hake would make dawning armor. Tap in an MMA fight. Yeah, I was thinking this song, I know you can do better than you even know, is Dawning Armor calling my show and, Hake, you can do better. what's up, man? Hake, if you didn't cut me off, you may have understood, says Dawning Armor. I may have misrepresented what he meant by his call. Not sure what he meant by grow a backbone. Hake, I'm sorry, but this music makes me forget every logical thought I was just thinking, says Skip. Music is so bad. Laughing a lot, says Bronco Adventures. I'm cleaning it up. Is Hake so darn wholesome? It sounds like New Kids on the Pot! Who was Mike Shinoda? I don't know. Deltron is an influence to this guy, I'm telling you, says Dave Clifton. The effects of multiculturalism, low standards. Ian bashing Dawning Armor, which I'm not, I don't really entertain the bashing stuff, but Ian did say something kind of funny. Donning was yet embarrassing yesterday with his G.I. Joes and tasting his own blood and biospirits. Pathetic. Aww. Fresh Prince and Jazzy Hake. De La Soul with a flute added. This is pure garbage, worse than anime. Anyway, guys, thank you for bearing with me through that. I will get to more of your calls, but first, I promised, and I don't like to break my promises, and then I will get to calls. I will, really. Don Lemon! Why I talk about Don Lemon? I have a couple of clips, and let me plow through these clips just to show you. Because are you guys familiar with Don Lemon today? He is a Trump hater. His face is turning... You know, he used to yuck lung. Yuck lung. He used to look young. Not that I cared. But now he looks dry and old and humorless. Lifeless. He is one of those radical homosexuals. Shameless. And encourages others to be shameless. Blind leading the blind. That's evil. And he's a Trump hater. He says, Trump is a racist. And if you hate Trump, you hate America. You hate white people. You hate Christians. That's just a fact. Right? You can't love anybody and hate Trump. You can't love anybody and hate anybody, right? Mike was Linkin Park in Fort Minor, says Den Tejian. Oh, okay. And so that's him now. He's a disgusting, evil person. And he always was, even back during this time. But he showed glimpses sometimes of little bits of fairness. Jake Tapper used to be similar. What happened with Jake Tapper? Has he retired or something? Is he, like, gone from... I haven't seen or heard anything from Jake Tapper. Was he a CNN guy? He was, right? I haven't seen or heard anything from him. Wonder what happened. Not that I care that much. You would be like, oh... You would applaud them just for showing a glimmer of fairness when that's supposed to be the standard. So anyway, here's a clip from July of 2013 it was shared on Mediaite, which is an outlet that covers media, but it's really a CNN clip. It's 5 minutes long, and it's Don Lemon talking about the blacks, and there was something floating in front of my face, so I grabbed it. If you were watching the video, you may have seen my hand go up. Don Lemon talking about five things the blacks can do better. And it's so shallow in a sense, but some of it's not bad or wrong. And then he plays another guy who's been disappeared from the media. A white man. Well, he's Irish. But white enough to be hated, and a male enough to be hated as a man, and old school enough to be... hated for telling the truth sometimes, right? Bill O'Reilly, he talks about Bill O'Reilly. He says, CNN's Don Lemon backs up Bill O'Reilly. He doesn't go far enough in criticizing black culture. And he says, more than 72% of black babies born out of wedlock. Wow. A glimmer of fairness from the media. Here's this clip from Don Lemon, July 2013, on CNN. Clip 12. Enjoy, guys.
The Trayvon Martin murder case got just about everybody talking about race, and not just specifically how it related to the case. It got some, many on the political right, wondering why the so-called liberal media wasn't talking about other problems in the black community.
Let's talk about race. Let's talk about black-on-black violence.
The outrage that I have is in the lack of really the national attention to what is an epidemic of crime in the black community committed largely by blacks.
Why aren't we talking about it? Good question. Actually, that's not a good question. We've talked about it many times on this show and on CNN.
Lip service.
It's actually a good deflection, as I've said a number of times to a number of guests here on CNN and also on the radio.
David, do not do that false equivalent. That is not a fair comparison.
No, I'm not trying to equivocate, but outrage.
Yeah, but,
no,
but listen,
I'm not comparing
crime
that.
Happens all the time, and because a crime happens, it does not mean that you should shift the focus from what happened here. Let's stick to this particular point.
Okay, so on this issue, then.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So that's the reason I didn't want to discuss at length crime in the African-American community or how to fix other ills that seem to be plaguing the community in general. But now that the jury has reached its verdict, one that everyone must accept, it's time now for some tough love on the subject.
It's Trayvon Martin.
Someone on another network got the chance to go first because I couldn't go during the week. I'm only here on the weekend, so listen to this.
The reason there is so much violence and chaos in the black precincts is the disintegration of the African American family.
Bill
O'Reilly. He's got a point. In fact, he's got more than a point. Bill?
Raised without much structure, young black men often reject education and gravitate towards the street culture, drugs, hustling, gangs. Nobody forces them to do that. Again, it is a personal decision.
He is right about that, too. But in my estimation, he doesn't go far enough. Because black people, if you really want to fix the problem, here's just five things that you should think about doing. Here's number five. And if this doesn't apply to you, if you're not doing this, then it doesn't apply to you. I'm not talking about you. Here's number five. Pull up your pants. Some people, a lot of them black, gave me flack for saying that recently on the Wendy Williams show.
If you're sagging, it means I think it's your self-esteem is sagging and who you are as a person, it's sagging. Young people need to be taught respect and there are rules.
Hey. Sagging pants, whether it's Justin Bieber or no-name Derek around the way, walking around with your ass and your underwear showing is not okay. In fact, comes from prison when they take away belts from the prisoner so that they can't make a weapon. And then it evolved into which role a prisoner would have during male-on-male prison sex. The one with the really low pants is a submissive one. You get my point? Number four now is the N-word.
For our generation, what we did was we took the word and we took the power out of that word.
We took this word and we made it into poetry.
I understand poetic license, but consider this. I hosted a special on the N-word, suggesting that black people stop using it, and that entertainers stop deluding yourselves or themselves and others that you're somehow taking the word back. By promoting the use of that word when it's not germane to the conversation, have you ever considered that you may just be perpetuating the stereotype the master intended, acting like a nigger?
Please.
A lot of African Americans took offense to that too, and I wondered if I gave the right advice. I really did. But confirmation came the very next day on my way home when I exited the subway on 125th Street in Harlem. This little kid in a school uniform, no older than 7 years old, he was crying his eyes out as he walked down the sidewalk with his mother. I'm going to be honest here. She turned to him and she said, "I'm sick of you. You act like an old ass man. Stop all that crying, nigger."
Mother.
Is that taking the word back? Think about that. Now, number three, respect where you live. Start small by not dropping trash, littering in your own communities. I've lived in several predominantly white neighborhoods in my life. I rarely, if ever, witness people littering. I live
Thank
in
you.
Harlem now. It's an historically black neighborhood. Every single day, I see adults and children dropping their trash on the ground when a garbage can is just feet away. Just being
litter
honest
bugs.
Here. Number
litter
two,
bugs.
Finish school. You want to break the cycle of poverty?
No,
stop telling kids are acting white because they go to school or they speak proper English. A high school dropout makes on average $19,000 a year. A high school graduate makes $28,000 a year. A college graduate makes $51,000 a year. Over the course of a career, a college grad will make nearly $1 million more than a high school graduate. That's a lot of money. And number one, and probably the most important, just because you can have a baby, it doesn't mean you should, especially without planning for one or getting married first. More than 72% of children in the African American community are born out of wedlock. That means absent fathers. And the studies show that lack of a male role model is an express train right to prison. And the cycle continues. So please, black folks, as I said, if this doesn't apply to you, I'm not talking to you. Pay attention to and think about what has been presented in recent history as acceptable behavior. pay close attention to the hip-hop and rap culture that many of you embrace, a culture that glorifies everything I just mentioned, thug and reprehensible behavior, a culture that is making a lot of people rich, just not you, and it's not going to. That said, though, the political right is not off the hook.
Oh, gosh.
If conservatives are so concerned about black-on-black crime, it's a little concerning. The only time I hear them talking about it is when they want to stick it to the black community.
Be quiet.
And that's today's Kirsten Powers. No talk.
That was lame Don Lemon being not completely lame. I see some of you guys in the chat didn't seem to know this. Didn't seem to know this about him. Wait, what? Don Lemon has logic? Says Raw Beats. Lemon probably doesn't believe the same nowadays, says D Subversion. Don Lemon sounds awfully white, to be honest. What's up, Nicole? Why are you trying to brainwash us by making us listen to this? Hake, says Jeanette Korzenko. I'm not trying to brainwash you by making you listen to this, Jeanette. I'm just saying, Don Lemon used to, in his imperfect solutions, stop sagging, stop saying the N-word. You don't have to stop saying the N-word. Just don't be so ridiculous about it. Littering, that was a great point. He said white, he said he's lived in many white communities. I'm not surprised. And they don't litter. And then in the black community where he lives, or lived, litter. Finish school, pushing college stuff. I don't agree with him there. Although finishing high school might be a good idea, I guess, right? Finish what you start, right? Stuff like that. But don't be going into the college stuff. Some of the blacks turn out worse. More radical, like many of the Asians. And dumb whites. End up dumb intellectuals, brainwashed and radicals after college and radical homosexuals. Making babies out of wedlock, though, he said. And they had to fact-check this on him. Fact-check him on this, or whatever. More than 72% of blacks' babies were born out of wedlock in 2013, or around that time. And to this day, they're doing it like that.
To this day!
Base Viking asks, how many Zionists mess did Don have to spend groveling? I'm cleaning up his language before he changed his stance. Used to be decent. What the heck happened? Asked LJ. Yeah, crazy, huh? So one more. I promised 10 minutes worth of clips. And by the way, at the end, they're talking about Kirsten. They're sharing Kirsten Powers clip. She's a so-called Christian, pretends to be a Christian, liberal, evil, nasty woman. She's the same one who hijacked Sean Hannity's show to go attack JLP for telling the truth about women and their voting, you know, the voting for insanity women, creating a shameless society, taking away the shame from society. And they were all talking about, by the way, and by the way, Don Lemon said the so-called liberal media. Oh, okay. Yeah, it's just so-called that they're liberal. They're communists, I guess. And he said, we talk about it. We talk about black violent crime a lot on this show. It's lip service. You're promoting the destruction, the LGBT mess, and the false victimhood with the Trayvon Martin case and many others. Georgia, Florida, to this day. Michael Brown.
To this day.
It was self-evident. It was self-defense. George Zimmerman shot Trayvon Martin in self-defense. That's what you are supposed to presume. All decent people presumed him innocent. There was no proof that he was guilty. It was clear from the start. So this, it's a deflection to talk about black-on-black crime. No. The attacking the white Hispanic George Zimmerman was the deflection from talking about reality of blacks hating whites. Anyway, that's Don Lemon. And one more from Don Lemon. This is Furguson, Missouri, a year later, or a little bit more than a year later. In November, that was July of 2013. This is November 2014. I promised you guys, I know I have a lot of callers to get to and stuff. I promised you guys 10 minutes worth of Don Lemon clips. So here's the other 5 minutes or so, maybe six, I don't know. This was shared by a black dude named Larry Finney on YouTube. He recorded a TV set from his cell phone. Anyway, this is from CNN, November 2014. CNN's Don Lemon versus the communist, and I call him communist, Van Jones after the Furguson riots. That was Mike Brown, the gentle giant who attacked the cop, former officer Darren Wilson. And they pretended, oh, Darren Wilson might have killed him when he had hands up, don't shoot, which he never did. False witnesses, lying witnesses. Some of the black witnesses were honest. Some of them were lying and said, oh, he had hands up, don't shoot. The forensics and the ballistics show that was not the case. The Furguson decision, Don Lemon and Van Jones argue live on CNN. Or maybe it was live, I think. Over the protests. By protests, they mean riots, out-of-control riots. When you watch this video, if you watch it, if you're listening, just know that on the side screen next to these guys, they're showing footage of the fires, the burning. Furguson was like a precursor to 2020 around the country when the Black Lives Matter set the country on fire and destroyed businesses. So listen to this.
Don Lemon. Quite honestly, in my estimation, it's been too much political correctness trying to appease protesters. And I don't mean people who are out there peacefully. There was nothing peaceful about last night. There were no peace. It was hard to be peaceful in that crowd. But I think trying to appease some people, I think that there needed to be a stronger hand with people who are marauding the streets and people who had the potential of setting fires. We saw what happened. Had the potential of harming people. We saw that played out. There has been a vacuum of leadership here, but also I think there's been it's been overly politically correct in many ways. I don't want to offend anyone. I don't want to come off as racist. It doesn't matter what color someone who is marauding or looting is, if they're black, white, purple, or green. If you're breaking the law and you have the potential to break the law, then he is right. You need to be arrested and you need to be held accountable.
You're shaking your head.
Well, I just saw it differently. First of all, the Van Jones. Especially when things first went bad, the vast majority of people out there were peaceful and were trying to be peaceful.
That's not true.
Sir, we were out there together. You had your view. I had my view. Yeah. The vast majority of people out there at the very beginning were trying to be peaceful. Then you saw way down the street, you saw a bunch of knuckleheads start a bunch of nonsense.
Knuckleheads.
Then they started bombarding with tear gas. Most of the people who were out there for good reason started to leave in large numbers. That boiled it down to a very small number of people. The small number of people who were left were either social bloggers and videographers or people who were out there trying to start
trouble. So the social bloggers and videographers were the people who were looting and burning down buildings?
Don't do this to me.
No, I'm just asking. I'm being honest.
There were two. We were out there together. We got tear gas together, and there were two.
You don't seem two together right now.
No,
I'm telling you that.
It's not their part.
Hold on a second. Hold on. What did you explain the part that Don's talking about? The looting was going on by large numbers of people.
Well, listen. There were large numbers of people out there. There were grown men out there crying. There were large numbers of people out there. They were not out there to cause trouble. Once you saw the troublemakers started, and we all got bombarded with tear gas, most of the people who were out there for good left in large numbers. That boiled it down, now you're right, to a smaller group of people.
One thing that seemed really odd to me was the timing and the planning.
Anticipation of a ball game or an event, people can, what is he going to say? What are they going to say? Is he going to be indicted? Is he not going to be indicted? Why is the prosecutor speaking so long? She's right about that. But I have to say, man, I'm sorry you're wrong. The small number of people out there may have started off as peaceful, but most of the people who were out last night, we're not blind.
I think we can all agree that looting
was illegal and
disappointing to
yelling and people were running. Hang on one second, let me finish. And when you people say, why aren't you reporting on the peaceful people? How do you know who's peaceful in a crowd of people who are racing towards you? How do police know whether it's water or urine or a Molotov cocktail in a bottle? When people say, why are they getting upset? Why are they arresting people?
Well,
I can't
let this stand.
All right, go ahead.
This is an insult to the people who were out there last night who were trying to
do a good job. No, I think it's an insult.
I am going to speak now.
Go ahead, Ben.
Now, listen. What was just said is an insult to the people of Furguson who have done more than 100 trainings for nonviolence. You say there was no leadership out there. The leadership would you let me finish, Don?
You're attributing things to me that I didn't say.
Go ahead. It is unfair to the people of Furguson who put in tremendous amounts of work to try to keep a lid on things, who were out there trying. The idea that people only came out for negative reasons is not true. The other thing is the idea that people were being too PC. That is, in fact, not true. Not true either. You saw large numbers of police who were saying exactly what needed to be said. You have to get out of the street. You cannot. Remember, we said order after order, and after those orders came, here comes the tear gas. So there's a lot of mythology that's been created, and it's not fair to the people who are out there trying to do
good.
Hold on, this has
nothing to do with the fair people of Furguson and the people who wanted peaceful protests. Of course, they have the right to protest, but you cannot say the majority of people who were out there last night were peaceful protesters.
Well, you can't. That's his opinion.
I don't disagree with what Van said. I don't think, though, that we saw the vast majority of the good people of Furguson on the streets last night. That's not what we saw.
Well, certainly the situation brought out
the worst
of everyone.
Let me say something about to the young people in Furguson who are trying to do the right thing. You're not wrong to care about your neighbor.
You're not
wrong to try to organize for positive change. And you're not wrong to feel hurt and sad. You can show more leadership today by saying, listen, this is not how we want to show ourselves to the world. It's disrespectful to the Mike Brown family to do this again. The young people now can step up where the older generation has failed, and I beg them
again. You're right, but that's not what we saw last night. Those aren't the people we saw last night.
Be the change you want to see, Sonny.
Those aren't the people we saw last night.
Thanks for giving me 2 days away. Hug it out.
Look, they're making him hug.
We talk about this all the time. Back to you in New York.
The two black liberals hugging. Van Jones says, it's not wrong to care about your neighbor. The blacks don't care about their neighbors. They don't. This was from the 2014 Trayvon Martin, when Trayvon Martin was killed by George Zimmerman in self-defense. Care about your neighbor. They don't care about him. They pretend they're in their minds they care because he's black and they hate whites. Organized for positive change. Van Jones historically used to be an avowed communist. He admitted to being a communist. He said, it's disrespectful to the Mike Brown family. Oh, no, this was after the Mike Brown situation. I was thinking the Trayvon Martin, the one before. The Mike Brown, the gentle giant who tried to kill the cop. Disrespectful to the Mike Brown family. Mike Brown didn't have a family. That was part of the whole problem. 100 trainings for nonviolence, Van Jones said. And right on at one point to wanna be fair, Don Lemon, the gay Trump hater, off the deep end Trump hater now, for admitting that there was nothing peaceful about the Furguson riots. Compare that to the mostly peaceful protest line that was repeated, lie, that was repeated ad nauseum or whatever. Is that a word? During the 2020 riots. And they were using it back then too, mostly peaceful. Van Jones called the rioters and the looters a bunch of knuckleheads. Reminds me of this black caller who called into my show referring to the Central Park Five who participated in what was called wilding, which were rapes, in some cases murders, assaults, and going crazy, blacks and some Hispanic younger people, so-called kids, teenagers, during the 80s and 90s in Central Park, New York City. And to this day, they just do that call. Oh, it's just wilding.
To this day.
They called it, this caller, black caller, he said, oh, they were rambunctious. And by the way, the Central Park Five were never exonerated for their crimes. People claim that they were exonerated. They never were. Van Jones, talk about, some of you guys caught that. Grown men crying. They were not troublemakers. Yes, they are. They're grown men crying because they hate white people. And they're trained to care about the Mike Brown death because they're automatically suspicious of the white man. And they're pretending that whites are automatically suspicious of them. It's projection. They hate whites. They hate cops. Mike Brown's stepfather, I think, even during that time. I will remind you, if you guys were aware of that at that time, or his mother's boyfriend, whatever he was, he got up onto a car after the grand jury refused to indict completely innocent former officer Darren Wilson in the so-called murder of Mike Brown. He shouted, burn this beat down! B word. Burn this beat down! And they burned it down. They went crazy. And was he ever called for inciting a riot? I don't think so. Van Jones, 100 trainings on nonviolence. Did the Tea Party, did the Proud Boys ever have to have trainings on nonviolence? I don't think so. They never had to, and they were never violent. Except in self-defense. Tea Party, Proud Boys, the alt-right, Only in self-defense. Van Jones talking about mythology of the riots. He's a dressed up green is the new red. He went from being a communist to being a green activist and exploiting capitalism to push communism. He's no different from what he ever was. And he was, it's even read in the minutes of this Van Jones guy, this black guy, minutes of the Congress, some guy, Barnett or something, read out loud quotes of him admitting to having been an avowed communist, and then he switched to being a more dressed up, acceptable radical in a suit. And Don Lemon, after all that fake gay fairness, has gone off the deep end, white hating, which he always was, but Trump derangement syndrome sufferer. So that's why I talked about Don Lemon, just because it's so shocking. Because Don Lemon was admitting that was no violent, that was no peaceful protest. Those were not mostly peaceful. Ridiculous. So anyway, that's that. Thank you for bearing with me through that. Hope that was not too hard to get through. 10 minutes of Don Lemon. Oh, man. Let me get to Martin. Or Martin, out of Portland, Oregon, a first-time caller. He wants to talk about the whites being too nice. Lines are full, guys. Hang tight. Martin, thanks for calling and holding. What's up?
Hey, how's it going?
Going well. Thank you.
I just had to call in because I'm working and I was driving here, and I really liked the discussion you guys had with that last caller, you and Chris, trying to explain the whole reasons why you guys are calling, you know, certain groups out or you know, blacks or whatever the subject matter is, and what we're seeing in the world today, in society, especially here in the U.S., with calling certain people out. I was kind of thinking about this, and you know how Jesse, on his show, he's promoting a lot of, like, to be an observer.
Yeah.
So, I really took that into account, and I've been doing that a lot lately, especially with doing the silent prayer. It's just a whole different approach, and I'm getting all these revelations. And it's just basically, you know, a lot of things that Jesse talks about and you talk about, they fall totally in line with scripture too. I wanted to throw this concept or this kind of idea across to you, and I want you to tell me what you think about it. But a lot of what I see going on with this whole debate going back and forth, it could be anything, but it's all the current events, especially with race. And one of the things that I noticed is that if you can kind of look at, like, the black people that we talk about, right?
Yeah.
And then white people and the whole war going on and the chaos, we like to identify and point out what we see, and it's kind of like a dysfunctional family, or a family that is, you know, has no order to it.
You're talking about whites?
I'm talking about whites. I'm talking about blacks. Let's look at white people as one family member, and then you got blacks as one family member. We're all different, right? And so how I was looking at it was like this. So the white people, and I'm talking about the upright white people, because obviously in
right.
every race we have good and bad, right? So I'm talking about the upright white people that Jesse's referring to is like one family member trying to call out and correct the other family member, which are the black people, and how they're doing the majority of, the crimes that they're doing are very evident and they're standing out.
Yeah.
Because it's like an out of control sibling that is, you know, not following morals, for example, like Jesse talks about, and we all talk about how, you know, they're not acting right. They're, you know, you got a family member in the family who's doing drugs, who's sleeping around. You know, that kind of lifestyle causes a person to kind of, it becomes evil. It is evil. And so with that evil, it's like having that one evil family member in the household and the chaos that they bring. And the chaos that they're bringing in the family is society. You know, we have, you know, whites, blacks, Asians, Hispanics, and all them, and we all have our culture and our habits, right? But for the majority, each culture and each family member, you know, like white person, Hispanic person, if you look at them as individual family members, and we're a whole family on this earth as humanity, what I'm seeing is the white people are warring with the black people, and everyone else is caught in between and getting influenced by one group or the other. One person's trying to, or one group of people, race, is trying to act right and live in society, build, you know, prosper in ways where they respect each other. And you could also look at white people as, like, you know, a body of people, which would be like one family member. And then you would also look at them like, you know, as a population. And then that population has its culture or its values. And then you got another one over here who has their culture and their values and what they practice daily. And then you see the fruits of the spirit coming out of that family member, right? So I don't know if you follow what I'm saying, but I'm trying to put it out there, because what I notice a lot that goes on the shows is there is a conflict about the conflict, but there's a failure to communicate. Like, obviously, we can tell them, hey, you know, you're doing this wrong, but they really have no it's inconceivable to them. Like, certain people you guys deal with.
What's inconceivable to them?
Well, like for example, I'll use an example with a family member of mine. She has, you know, her kids. And what I see is she'll say something like, to correct them, she'll say, you're not showing respect, right? Or you're being, you know, you're being this way. But the child doesn't really have a concept of what respect is, right?
Okay.
Like, she'll say, hey, you're not respecting your uncle, or respect your uncle.
So you're saying that, so you're saying blacks don't have a concept of the respect and the civilization that whites are trying to call them to.
Exactly. Yeah. So, and Jesse, what I see what Jesse does, and I'm sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off, but what I see that Jesse's trying to do is he's trying to have a conversation, and he's trying to kind of get down to the nitty gritty. He uses his psychology tactics to when he questions them, he's trying to have them open up. And then what he does is he brings them around to kind of help them see themselves, you know. And what I see is going on between the whites and the blacks is, you know, like, for example, there's bad in the white race, you know, they do certain crimes, and then there's the blacks, right? The whites are saying, or the good whites, like yourself and everyone on the show, is saying, hey, you guys are doing this, this, and this, and look, and showing proof to them, right? But the blacks over here are denying because of their bad habit. You know, you've seen bad people that, like, they'll lie for their loved ones instead of,
right,
even if they did a crime, right?
Yep.
And we look at that and we're like, hey, man, like, don't cover it up, you know, because then it just creates more corruption.
And then, out of curiosity, right? Are you white or Hispanic or black or what? Or Asian?
I'm Hispanic.
Okay.
Yeah. Nice. And,
so was I correct to pronounce it Martin?
Yeah, well, I mean, yeah. It's
technically.
Fun, but yeah, totally. I have no problem. Yeah.
Does anybody call you Martin?
Yeah, my neighbor calls me Martin. And a lot of people ask me that. They say, hey, is it okay if I call you Martin, or do you want to be called Martin or what? And I'm like, I don't care. Just, you know.
I felt silly saying it because I was like, oh, from Portland, maybe he's white.
Yeah, I got a buddy of mine I used to work with, and he's like, Martin, like that.
Yeah.
Every time he sees me. But no, I wanted to say that I really appreciate you guys talking about it. But what I'm going back to what I was saying, my example is that my sister doesn't sit down and explain or give examples of what respect is.
Do they have their father? Your nephews and nieces?
No, and that's another thing. My sister, you know, I'm not trying to put her dirt out there, but it's just her children.
Is out of out of wedlock or something?
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
And, dude, I totally see everything that Jesse talks about is like if it was in a textbook, that'd be my sister, you know.
The mother's destroying the children and turning the children away from the fathers and treating them with anger and impatience and spoiling and all that stuff.
I mean, it's like, bam, bam, bam. If you're hitting the nails on the coffin, it's like, boom, boom, boom. And I see how also children, like, because she has to work, right? And so I see this behavior come out of them, because it's like they have nobody to guide them, nobody to sit down and... It's like, even in their education, I see that they're struggling so bad that the teachers already kind of expect that they know how to read or that they have the basics, and they don't have those basics. So when the teacher's trying to work with them, she can't even teach them what she wants to teach them of the subject, because she literally would have to go down and break it down to teach them the alphabet all over again. And it's the same issue going on, like as that being an example, it's the same issue with certain groups, particularly I see this with the Black community, is I see the same thing that's going on with my sister and her kids. It's going on with the Black in the families, you know, the fatherless homes, the mother just on a fight or flight all the time. And that's how they operate. It's like a 0 to 60, 0 to angry, 0 to, and they use intimidation. They use, because you've seen.
That's all they have. They don't have real authority. It was funny hearing Don Lemon recount that story of that Black mother yelling at her little daughter or son, whatever, calling him a N-word.
Yeah, and you sit there and you're like,
and
what
that's
the
so
heck?
Typical.
Then, yeah,
in public,
and I even
no
see
shame.
And I see it in the Hispanic communities too.
Yeah,
the mother yelling, and then it's almost like they have this self-righteousness where they think, oh, you know, I look good because I'm disciplining my child, and I'm also saying, you know, things that would be, I guess, approved by society.
Right.
Oh, yeah.
And society, society totally kisses up. Speaking of, you know, that 2014 Furguson riot stuff that I just mentioned, there was this viral video that Jesse Lee Peterson covered during that time with he had a word on the street thing that he would do. And he covered this case where this fat single Black mother slapping her teenage or 12-year-old or teenage, he looked pretty grown, son who was out looting and rioting, and she's there slapping him, trying to get him, bring him back home, and that got caught on video, viral video, and everybody's like, oh, that's a great mother, she's trying to stop him from rioting, which that's fine, but she was treating him with anger, and she's a bad example of a person. If she was a good example of a mother, he wouldn't be out there out of control like that. And she got put on Oprah, and you're right, society applauds that type of mother who's single mother
and
kissing up.
Yeah. And it's crazy because they're not seeing how they're damaging the children and recreating like pissed off people. People are pissed, and they're like, they grow up and they're like, you know, I mean, I myself, I thought, you know, that I had a pretty decent childhood, and then I sit back and think about, you know, why I have so much anger, or, you know, I'm getting personal here, but it's like, I've lived it too, you know? I mean, I grew up where I had self-hate.
Did you have both parents or just your mother or what?
No, the thing is my parents did it right. Like,
okay, yeah. But even then, the weak father, the evil mother.
Well, check this out. See, this is. I'm glad that we're talking about this because I actually just realized this year. So both my parents came from fatherless homes, and my father had a stepfather, and they both came from abusive homes. And the story, like, once
abusive by the mothers,
my father, his stepfather would beat him, and I would always remember my dad telling us that his mother would say, oh, you're crazy, because he was like, he had a lot of ideas. He was very creative, right? And he was ambitious, you know, because they came from poverty. So he had drive to want to do things in life, and his mother would always put him down and say, oh, you're crazy, or, you know, in Spanish, she would say, estás loco, you know? And even till him being an adult, when I remember, he would have talks with me, and it would drive him crazy. He'd get himself worked up from that. And then he would even bring it into the family where if he felt nobody was listening to them, he would always be repeating, oh, you guys throw me to the lions. Oh, you guys, you know, nobody listens to me. And then he'll bring up his mom again. And then he had a lot of trauma. I mean, his stepfather would beat him, and he didn't get to really meet his father. And so I saw in my father like, he didn't know how to be a dad or how to be a man.
Right.
You know, it wasn't that he was like beta because he was trying to be like a wimp or anything like that. He was a very like strong man. He used that intimidation that you see a lot in people that don't have God in their life.
Right.
Like the black people, this intimidation, like, because it's all built, that whole intimidation and that character that everybody holds on to is built off of trauma and fear, and they don't want people to see their vulnerabilities, right? So they built this fake persona, this ego, and that's what they present to the world, so they can like say, hey, you know, don't mess with me, or don't get close to my wounds, basically.
Yeah,
my hidden wounds. And you see that coming out in, you know, in black people and their
right.
culture.
Yeah.
And what they promote, and it's just a self-perpetuating cycle. And you also see that in the whites, you see that in the Hispanics. My wife is Asian, and I was, you know, around a lot of Asians, and you see that they have their own issues.
Yeah.
Where they grow up like loveless, like they don't show love and affection. It's all about money and success and status. With the Hispanics, man, they're always putting each other down. I mean, to your face, they'll throw up the front, you know, hey, just to look good in the community, like in out in public. But, you know, they really have a lot of jealousy and envy.
Backstabbers. And, yep. I know
yeah,
that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Two-faced stuff. And
yep.
then you got, I mean, and then with the blacks, the same thing, you know, and it's like, it's just.
No, I kind of get your point, man. Yeah, I get yeah. you. Interesting.
And so I'm glad that you guys bring it up, and you kind of got into it deeper, and you had Chris explain it, and I could see he was struggling in a way to get the message through to the guy, because that guy was, you know, he's still trying to figure it out. And it's like, dude, don't be afraid because you're doing the right thing.
Right.
You know, don't be afraid that people are going to hate on you, because if we don't speak truth, if we don't try to break it down for them to help them understand, then all we're doing is allowing, like, for example, the family member to continue down their path. We don't love them, we don't care about them, and we just allow them to die off.
Yeah.
And what kind of person are we if we're not caring? You know the story in Genesis where...
Martin, man, can you call me tomorrow on this Genesis story? I gotta run, but I really appreciate
yeah, yeah.
your call, man. Great call.
No, I appreciate you guys. Thank you.
All right, take care, man.
All right, you too. Bye.
All right. That's cool. Taking care of businesses. Jesse says it how it is. That's why I respect the man. Is that what the caller is trying to say? I think so, yeah. Because taking care of business bears is bristling at the failure to communicate line. Yeah. Azador says about the Don Lemon situation and the super chats, guys, super chats. And the Van Jones stuff, these people weren't giving their own opinions then or now. They are whores. Their masters set a narrative at any given time and they spin it. Yeah. Go to school. Finish school. They just get more and more pretending to be reasonable. And then they just go off the deep end. It's so evil. You Know Me gave a super chat on streamlabs.com/TheHakeReport and said, so good. Quoting me. You're absolutely right, Hake. Thank you for the Furthermore Music Week. I enjoy most of their music and the new tracks you've played so far. Well, you're right. You're welcome, You Know Me. Nice. I appreciate that. Thank you for the special request and for the support, as always. Single Mom Doing Her Best says, donning armor, referring to my caller yesterday who just totally changed the direction of my show yesterday in the beginning of the second hour. Told me to get a backbone. In what way? I'm not exactly clear. Maybe I'll talk with him again. Donning armor, weren't you the same guy who invited Hake out for sushi in private, right? After he owned a black collar while you were on hold? Hake doesn't roll that way, dude. Are you spreading rumors, Single Mom Doing Her Best? I don't remember that. Is that true? I don't know. Anyway, lines are full, guys. I appreciate the super chats. Oh, there was another super chat that I saw from Odyssey, odyssee.com/@TheHakeReport. Don Lemon says, taking care of business bear. or taking care of business. The only guy that makes people Chris Cuomo, like Chris Cuomo, come out of the closet on live TV. whoa. What are you talking about? Taking care of business, man. But yeah, those people are nuts. I'm going to have to share that. Should I share this clip? Okay, callers, lines are full. I will get to you. I do promise. Well, many of you. I'll get to many of you. But let me play this clip because it's just too funny to keep on putting off. I didn't play it for you yesterday because I had not bleeped it. This is from that guy, 50 Shades of Way. Dave New World underscore two or whatever. His liberal, communist, anti-white, anti-American, anti-Christian, anti-common sense mess was on Twitter, sharing viral videos on Twitter, but having horrible takes on them. This is what he shared on Twitter. This was clip 11. 50 Shades of Way on Twitter. Guy complains about a leaf blower. Don't you hate those fellow whites? Not fellow whites, but whites. And this lawn care worker wasn't having it. So the scene is, it's a beautiful, well-treed, green, beautiful, perhaps a white neighborhood. I don't know. I don't even know what the race of the guy who's filming this this cell phone video is. But he's showing this huge, bigger than you've ever seen gardening truck. And these gardeners, they call them lawn care workers. Give me a break. One of them has a blower, a gas blower, which I guess is banned in certain cities because it's bad for the environment. That's not my concern about blowers, leaf blowers. It kicks up dust and it can get in your eyes if you're not wearing sunglasses. And even then, sometimes it gets in your eyes and they're noisy and it blows up the dust into the windows and stuff, I think. Well, so this guy's complaining about it and he claims that there's a city ordinance against it. It may be tough to understand, but listen to this. And then there's another guy who's on a truck, on a pile of like leaves or tools or whatever. And he comes down and, well, listen to this and watch. You probably can imagine what he's doing, those of you who are listening on the audio podcast. Enjoy this clip or not.
Hey, man, I don't get why you guys are being so aggressive about this. I've asked you to stop using that. They're not allowed.
Look at that truck. Not allowed.
Bro, you're making my life difficult. Everybody that lives on this block, we can't have our windows open. Just because this house wants some leaves removed doesn't mean that you guys get a break sitting in the ordinance.
Here for 10 minutes.
I don't care.
We don't care either, bro.
All right,
so watch out who the f*** comes from like that, bro. Thank you, bro. I'm going to let you know right now, nigga. Tell the cops I don't give a f*** with you, bro.
All right,
bro. I'm not him, and I'm not the one in charge, bro.
Who's in charge, then?
Whoa. Pardon the vulgar gesture.
Dude, are you gonna get in my face? All right, I'll
taking off his jacket.
I'll leave. I'll leave.
What's up, bro?
Hey, I'm gonna leave.
What's up, bro?
Taking off his shirt.
Yo, I'm leaving, man. Right, I'm getting out of your face.
Get the f*** on my face, bro.
I will.
Cause I'm not the one, bro.
All right.
All right, bro.
All right.
I appreciate you, nigga.
All right.
We're working hard, bro.
All right.
Are you gonna come f*** with us, bro?
All right. I'm getting out of here, man. I'm getting out of here.
Nice white man. I don't know if this guy's white. Maybe he's black or something else. I doubt that he's black because the Mexican guy is calling him N-word. I'm calling him Mexican, but I don't know. He looks like he's Hispanic. Maybe he's Samoan. Takes off his whole shirt. Getting out of our country. So the gardener guy who looks like he's working for this huge company, if you guys watched the video, have you ever seen a truck like that, a gardening truck like that with a trailer for the tools and a truck for the leaves and all that stuff? Dang, that was hilarious. You literally run off that guy. What is he, flexing delusional? No, that guy is pretty big though. He literally took off his hoodie thing. Like, unzipped it, took off his hat and sunglasses, this Hispanic guy who got down all the way out of his truck, got heated. I don't know what type of confrontation that led up to this, because we didn't see the whole confrontation. He turns on his cell phone because the guy is getting heated, I guess. He's like, I don't know why you guys are getting so aggressive about this. Because I guess he confronted the guys, hey, turn off that leaf blower. You guys know what leaf blowers are? Please wear a shirt. Hake is so sheltered, guys. Crazy. 20 seconds and the Mexican would have ran out of wind. But anyway, I think the guy did the right... In my opinion, they were calling this guy a male Karen, which is a slur upon white people. You know, white people looking out for their community, white women looking out for their community, saying, hey, you're just not supposed to... There's a city ordinance against leaf blowers. And some of it is this climate environmentalist mess. But some of it is, it's legitimately, you have to close your windows, the leaf blower is too loud, it's kicking up dust, and it's a mess. Mow, blow, and go is what a lot of these people do. And leaf blowers, a lot of people use leaf blowers, and they wouldn't get as much done without them. Well, imagine you have to carry a rake all the time and rake all those leaves. Yeah. Matt the American, you have a leaf blower? You one of those annoying, I'm not the one, you got the wrong guy, N-word. Whites like being called the N-word, by the way. Well, not all whites. Just the wig gnats. Just the wiggers. Anyway, I just had to share that with you. This guy, the people in the Twitter feed were on the side of the Hispanic guy, but I felt that the Hispanic guy was wrong. They got the wrong attitude. I wonder if that guy got fired after that. Anyway, just an entertaining little clip for you. What a mess. Let me get to Maze, my favorite caller from Dayton, Ohio, on the line. What's up, Maze?
Hello, James. How are you today?
Fine. How are you?
I'm just fine. I have a question.
Yes.
And I want an honest answer. Now, y'all, your Caucasians are always talking about what other people should do. Who's to tell y'all what y'all need to be doing?
Repeat your question. Is that for Chris or is this for me?
Chris and you.
Repeat your question.
Especially Chris.
I tuned you out.
Who's there to tell Caucasians what they need to be doing and being corrected? Who's supposed to tell them?
One another. We self-correct.
Really?
We look at ourselves. We listen to Jesse Lee Peterson, who also corrects us. And we correct one another. And we look at ourselves. We do the silent prayer. So, yeah.
I didn't say we, not the little group that you're in. You know what I'm saying? The angry ones.
Whites at large?
No, the angry ones that hate people, don't know how to love, know what love is. Those kind of people, like Chris.
Chris?
He's mixed up real bad.
You want to answer this question, Chris?
In brief, I'd say I don't need to be corrected. I do.
I know you don't. I'm just asking you a question. Who's there to correct you when you're wrong? When you're doing something like on opioids and all this, doing.
We don't do opioids.
All this stuff. Who's there to correct you when
don't do opioids, whites?
I'm saying your people.
And don't commit suicide.
I'm saying yes.
We're working on it.
Yeah. They shouldn't be doing it.
We're working on it.
Thank you for the love, Mace.
Working on it.
Thank you for
the
love.
But you don't want other people to talk about it. But you always want to talk about other people's ills. Believe yours.
That's you. That's you, Mace.
I know what y'all do.
We talk about our ills.
No, you don't.
Yeah, we do.
You don't even.
Yeah,
if you they don't even show it on the TV. And the only way you got to know
they do.
It.
Other
know
people.
That look
other
like
people
you.
Talk about. Other people talk about.
You got your people got problems. How
other people talk about us?
I'm asking you the question.
Yeah.
How you gonna solve the problem y'all got?
Oh, I told
That's
you,
okay.
We're working on it.
Solve?
We're working on it. And the
working
thing is,
it.
When James and I talk about the non-whites, we actually want to help them. We don't want to bring them down.
Well, we don't need your help. How y'all going to help somebody and you don't have nothing?
The non-whites.
You don't have
and there's decent ones out there. I'll take their
you're not even around the
advice,
you're about.
Jesse, some others. I'll take their
Jesse
advice,
can talk
certainly.
About as long as he want to.
But most of the time,
you,
people like you and others... They,
no, like
they,
you,
their corrections
you full of it.
Want
you
to
do
bring
to
me
work.
Down.
One at a
they
time, Maze.
You.
Maze, you're talking and not listening. He answered your question, and you were just talking the whole way through it. What the heck?
No, if I can pull up the same videos he pulled up and talk about.
You people misdiagnose white.
I think the
no,
audience
people,
heard what I
no,
said.
No, no,
yeah.
You people misdiagnose. Y'all don't know nobody look like nobody but Jesse.
Well, I appreciate it, Maze. Great.
That's the only people you know.
Great
so Chris,
input.
Find some videos of yourself showing to compare of what y'all doing every day that the news don't show us. You see, that's why Facebook and YouTube
Thank
and
you,
all
Maze.
That, we can see everything y'all do. We can
Gotta
put
go.
The same thing. And use something update Don Lemon did, not something way back there.
No, that was the last sensible thing Lemon said.
When you walk
Thank
around
you,
with green, orange, and yellow hair,
Gotta go.
Your pants hanging
you have
off
a good
looking
day.
Like a broke-down hippie. Don't nobody have nothing to say about
I know.
That.
You
so
have
get
a good day.
Together. So don't, y'all can't tell us what to do.
He called out Justin Bieber, too.
You lost yourself. Have a good one.
You too. Thank you. Tony in California wanted to talk about white greed. Man, Joe in Phoenix, Arizona says, black people are not miserable. Robert in Kansas wanted to talk about the FBI crackdown against parents who are against the CRT, anti-white, anti-American, anti-decency. William in California wanted to talk about the being honest with the blacks. And the rest of the callers, I cannot get to you, but I appreciate it. Hopefully tomorrow. Anyway, thehakereport.com, rebuildingtheman.com/church for the Throwback Sunday service. Thanks, guys, and take care. Yeah.